بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. We continue reading from Imam al-Ghazali's جواهر القرآن, the jewels of the Quran. We have reached سورة النجم. And Imam al-Ghazali chose verses 42 to 49. These are eight verses, eight jewels, if you will. Imam Ghazali skipped Surah At-Tur, so we have dealt with Al-Dhariyat, and nothing was chosen from Surah At-Tur. Though there are, one might say that the scene depicted in Surah Tur belongs to Islamic eschatology, end of time scenario, the collapse of the cosmos, of the natural order. And then a vivid description of hellfire, and of course there is a vivid description of paradise. But as I said, Imam Ghazali did not really choose anything from this particular chapter. So Surah An-Najm, we pave our way to what Imam Ghazali selected in to verse 42. These are short verses, and it begins with an oath, with the stars when the translation says here fade away. The literal Arabic, the word is hawa, and that's like saqata, fell. One najm, it could be, of course it is singular, but also in Arabic it is used instead of the plural. And if one, if Surah At-Tur, which of course Imam Ghazali did not choose anything from it, is part of the context, just think about the collapse of the universe at the end of time. I think يومت تبدل الأرض غير الأرض والسماوات, so there'll be dramatic changes. So probably including the meaning of how other fade away, that should be fine, but the but fade away not as be the star becoming old, and therefore the light dimmed. I think it's the very end. Think what happens to stars when they are swallowed, well, I mean metaphorically speaking, by black holes. This the answer to this oath is that your fellow man, and who is your fellow man? This is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He is neither misguided nor astray. ما ضل صاحبكم وما غوى وما ينطق عن الهوى. Nor does he speak of his own whims. It is only a revelation. وما ينطق عن الهوى. إن هو إلا وحي يوحى. It is only a revelation sent down to him. He has been taught by one angel of mighty power and great perfection who once rose to his true form. This is a reference to Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam, the archangel, who used to come, used to show up before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, taking human form, remember, anthropomorphic forms. And this is also how angels, for example, showed up in the Torah when they visited Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, Prophet Abraham, on their way to the people of Lot. And there will be something here about the people of Lot later on, inshallah. But in his angelic form, twice the Prophet ﷺ saw him in his angelic form. And it was the first time it was like too much for the Prophet ﷺ to handle. So so majestic, if you will. And the second time he saw him during the night journey, during the ascension, when they reached the subhanallah, that was when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam received the divine order, the divine commandment, that to pray the five daily prayers. Is a longer version, of course, or longer story. So ذو مرة فاستوى وهو بالأفق الأعلى, while on the highest point above the horizon. Then he approached the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Then he approached, coming so close. ثم دنا فتدلى فكان قاب قوسين أو أدنى, that he was only two arms length away, or even less. Two arms lengths. Two, if you talk about two bows, as in bow and arrow, two bows length, that's the literal meaning. Wallahu subhanahu wa ta'ala ala wa alam. Then Allah revealed to his servant what he revealed. فَأَوْحَى إِلَىٰ عَبِدِهِ مَا أَوْحَى. Of course, he revealed to through Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam. ما كذب الفؤاد ما رأى أفتمارونه على ما يرى ولقد رآه نزلة أخرى عند سدرة المنتهى. Difference in interpretation is about how to understand ما كذب الفؤاد ما رأى. Here is translated, for example, as the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, the Prophet's heart did not doubt what he saw, meaning the Prophet ﷺ saw something and his heart did not deny it, did not doubt it. There is another interpretation whereby it is the heart itself that saw. So it's not seeing with the eyes and the head. It's basically something that belongs to the heart. I think it's very important to realize this. So عند سدرة المنتهى, عند جنة المأوى, near which is the garden of eternal residence. إذ يغشى السدرة ما يغشى ما زاغ البصر وما طغى. This is while the Lot tree was overwhelmed with the heavenly splendors, the prophet's sight never wandered, nor did it overreach. لقد رأى من آية ربه الكبرى. He certainly saw some of the Lord's, of his Lord's greatest signs. Then there is mention of idols that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, of course, he destroyed the idols that existed in the Haram, in the Masjid al-Haram, all the idols that surrounded the Kaaba, when Mecca was conquered. Though the word Fath is the appropriate word. There's a hadith about Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha. She was asked whether Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم saw his Lord, and so the companions were not on the same page regarding this issue. So Ibn Abbas, it's been reported, رضي الله عنهما, he reported that the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم saw his Lord, but Aisha and of course Ibn Mas'ud, they denied this for the suffix pronoun in ra'ah, وَلَقَدْ رَأَهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى عِنْدَ سِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَى, that it's a reference to Jibreel عليه السلام. عائشة الله عنها said in the hadith, he who claims that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم saw his Lord, فقد أعظم الفرية. This is like a big lie. فإن الله قال في كتاب الكريم, لا تدرك الأبصار وهو يدرك الأبصار وهو اللطيف الخبير. نعم. So seeing with the heart is different from claiming. That would be a way out, if you will. Then there is reference to these idols that were destroyed later on. Now, have you considered the idols of Lat and Uzza, and the third one, Manat, as well? And if one reads about the history of these idols, people who brought, when they traded with other regions, like the two major trade routes, one to Sham to the north and one to Yemen in the south, and people started bringing idols during their journeys. Do you prefer to have sons while you attribute to him, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, daughters, a female? Then this is truly a biased distribution. Verily, these idols are mere names that you and your forefathers have made up, a practice Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has never authorized. إن هي إلا أسماء سميتموها أنتم وآباؤكم ما أنزل الله بها من سلطان. They follow nothing but inherited assumptions and whatever their souls desire, although true guidance has already come to them from their Lord. يتبعون إلا الظن وما تهوى الأنفس ولقد جاءهم من ربهم الهدى. Or should every person simply have whatever intercessors they desire? أم للإنسان ما تمنى فلله الآخرة والأولى. In fact, Allah alone belongs this world and the next. the translation reverse the order. To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala belongs the next and this one. And regarding intercession, imagine how many noble angels are in the heavens. Even their intercession would be of no benefit whatsoever until Allah gives permission to whomever He wills, and only to the for the people He approves. Indeed, those who do not believe in the hereafter label angels as female. The angels are neither male nor female. Because if you say male and female, this, you are assuming that there is you might say masculine names, but the angels do not procreate, and the division of male and female assumes that there is some kind of biological life that does not even exist. Remember that the angels on the way to the people of Sayyidina Lut alayhi salam, when Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam offered them food, the roasted fat calf, they refrained. They did not eat. This did not register well with Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam, who got worried, got afraid. But they comforted him and they explained that they were on the way to the people of Lut. So even when they take anthropomorphic form, they don't consume food. Think in the Old Testament they did eat, but it should not be the case. This is where the Muhaymin, the Quran, has the upper hand when we differ, when we have differences in the narrative. Now, amongst those who are mentioned in this surah, in terms of the prophets and the peoples, Sayyidina Musa alayhi salam is mentioned, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam is mentioned. In fact, Sayyidina Ibrahim alayhi salam is mentioned as the one who fulfilled, meaning fulfilled his covenant. The verses that Imam Ghazali selected, 42 to 49, and that your Lord alone is the ultimate return, I mean, of all things, of but especially for us. Moreover, He is the one who brings about joy and sadness. There's a Imam Ghazali in Kitab Raja wal Khawf. He mentions a story about hope and fear, that Maruf al-Karakh was on the bank of the Tigris, Dijla, in Iraq. You have the Euphrates and Tigris. Al-Furat wa Dijla. So he was with a group of people sitting on the bank of Dijla, and they saw a group of young men. They were having fun, but also they were drinking wine. So some of those in his company asked him, and Maruf al-Karakh is someone who's a Sufi, to my knowledge. They asked him to supplicate, to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make a supplication to curse them, against them. And obviously because they were drinking wine. So he raised his hands and he made a supplication. He said, Ilahi, كما فرحتهم في الدنيا فرحهم في الآخرة. O my Lord, in as much as you have made them, you permitted them, you allowed them, you to have fun in this life, also grant them a joyous end in the hereafter. And those in his company were puzzled by his supplication, because they expected that they wanted him to curse them. And when they asked him why he made such a supplication, he said, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that was his prayer, that was his supplication, if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grants him a joyous end in the hereafter, he would grant them repentance. So, وَأَنَّهُ أَضْحَكَ وَأَبْكَى. There is, of course, if you have, if you suffer, you might be influenced. Is it possible that you get depressed? Yes. Clinical depression? Yes. Do you need to seek professional help? That's the best thing to do. But also one might remember that not having close relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not making dhikr, will lead to psychological issues. Okay. وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِ فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. Those who do steer away, they do not remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they will have a life of hardship. On the other hand, أَلَا بِذِكْرِ اللَّهِ تَطْمَئِنُ الْقُلُوبُ. If you remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, your heart will be filled with tranquility. And he is the one who gives life and causes death. And وَأَنَّهُ أَمَاتَ وَأَحْيَا. وَأَنَّهُ خَلَقَ الزَّوْجَيْنِ ذَكَرُ الْأُنْثَى. And he created the pairs, males and females. مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ إِذَا تُمْنَى. From a sperm drop, when it is emitted. وَأَنَّ عَلَيْهِ النَّشْأَةَ الْأُخْرَى. It is upon him to bring about recreation. It is he, and he is the one who enriches and impoverishes. You still need to exert your effort, but at the same time you know very well that everything is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but you still need to roll up your sleeves, and because you don't know what's really your what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for you. Now the next verse, wa ana huwa rabbu ash-shi'ra. I think this is a remarkable thing to say. Remember that at the very beginning, wa najm idha hawa. Now try to relate it to this verse. وَأَنَّهُ رَبُّ الشِّعْرَى. And he is alone the Lord of Sirius. This is a star that was worshipped by some ancient pagans. And Sirius belongs to constellation Canis Major, or the greater dog. And typically it's the brightest star in the constellation. It's the brightest star in the sun, in the sky, other than our sun, other than the moon, other than Venus. It depends. Other planets might be bright, but in general, it is Sirius that it is the brightest star. And so think about the beginning of the surah and this particular verse. So the stars are going to والنجم إذا هوى. They are going to end. They are going to collapse. They are going to fall. They are going. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, rather than worshipping these stars, these planets, these natural phenomena, do worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For He is the Lord of everything. He is the Lord of the universe. He is the Lord of this particular star that people worship. And then this is the end of the of Imam Ghazali's selection, but next the verses start speaking about the peoples who were punished, and for example وَأَنَّهُ أَهْلَكَ عَادًا الْأُولَى, the people of Ad, he destroyed the people of Ad. وثمود فما أبقى, then ثمود, sparing no one. وقوم نوح من قبل إنهم كانوا هم أظلم وأطغى, and then before that he destroyed the people of Noah, سيدنا نوح عليه السلام, who were far worse in wrongdoing and transgression. والمؤتفكة أهوى, these were the people of Sayyidina Lut alayhi salam, and the biblical narrative is about Sodom and Gomorrah. Archaeologists say that they are on the eastern side of the Dead Sea, and they were their places of residence were turned upside down, and hence the Mu'tafika. Subhanallah. It's a warning for people who have vivid hearts, who understand that it's a warning. It's a warning. These verses. Think about the universe. It's going to end. Think about there will be Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will recreate people. He will quicken the dead. This universe that we know is going to end. Think about the peoples who came before and who were punished severely. The very last, in fact, it's the Quran says, in fact, it brings our attention, it reprimands the reader, the people, that the hour has drawn near. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can disclose the hour. And do you find this revelation astonishing? Laughing at it and not weeping in awe, while persisting in heedlessness. The very last verse sums up what is required. Instead, prostrate to Allah and worship Him alone. فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَعْبُدُوا. سُبْحَانَ اللَّهُ وَحَمْدُ اللَّهِ وَلَا إِلَهُ اللَّهُ أَكْبَرُ. The next selection will be inshallah from Surah Al-Qamar. Imam Ghazali chose 7 verses. Until then, Subhanakallah wa hamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.